Why in your movies and your discussions do you selectively ignore and misrepresent the recent burgeoning medical and behavioral literature that demonstrates that gender-affirming care and similar medical interventions demonstrate consistent improvements to mental health, suicidality, and general well-being?
Which study are those?
There are probably like 30 studies by this point, all produced in the last like 10 years or so. Anybody can look them up on...
Okay, well, just here's the problem. Med. Here's the problem. I'm not impressed by just you saying a study.
No,
okay?
Because studies.
Fine. Well, there could be 100 studies. There could be 1,000 studies.
Them.
Great. Yeah. And I have read them. Have you?
Yes, I have.
Okay. So here's, I'll give you one example. I don't know if you can give me any examples, but I'll give you one example of a recent study that and this was just in the headlines. It said that it proved that double mastectomies for minor girls improves their well-being. And this was a study, and it was proven, peer-reviewed. Then you read how they actually conducted this study, and you find out that they interviewed a very small selection of girls in one region of the country, all from the same socioeconomic background, and they did their follow-up, I think it was 3 months later. And based on a follow-up a few months later, they've determined that, oh, yeah, it improves well-being. You see the problem here? No,
yes,
I don't.
There are many, but there are. This is the exception to the rule. Many.
I don't think it is.
Use observational data with various follow-up from like 6 months to 5 years to 10 years, and they don't demonstrate what you claim.
Well, you can say the word study, but what I'm saying
you
is when you
look them up.
Okay,
they're
great.
Like,
great.
You can Google them.
Yeah, and so can you. It sounds like you have it.
I've done it a good bit.
Oh, you've done it a good bit. Okay, all right. Well, I just
PubMed,
gave you an
transgender health, PubMed, NIH, gender-affirming care, and I mean it's
okay.
It's
let me ask you.
Anybody can look at this.
What's your name?
Jacob.
Jacob, let me ask you this: how do you think they would have large-scale, long-term studies about the effects of these drugs and these surgeries on children when we only started doing it to children at a large scale a few years ago? So how could that even exist?
Yeah, I think scale is probably one of the more prevalent challenges of these studies.
Okay, so we're already hearing that there are challenges in these studies.
Yeah, every study has challenges. Like, any scientific truth, like all of the scientific truth that we take for granted today, they're built on methodologies that fundamentally have flaws. Like, if you want to make a specific critique, you can do that. If you're talking about...
I just did.
Well, if you're talking about sample size, there are very well-demonstrated statistical results that you don't need 10,000 people to get, like, a statistically significant value.
Yes,
no,
you do.
You don't.
No,
absolutely not. It's like a very basic statistical
Jacob.
Fact.
Here's Jacob.
A sample size greater than 1,000, that can, like, that has very nice asymptotic properties. Like,
Jacob, here's what I know. If you want to even begin to claim that a study has proven that castrating and sterilizing little boys helps them in the long run, then you would need to have a large sample size of children who've gone through these procedures, and we've checked back with them in adulthood to see how they're doing. Those studies do not exist. They can't exist because we weren't doing this to kids at anywhere near this scale even 5 years ago, let alone 10 years ago. What that tells us, Jacob, is that the kids we have right now, they are the sample.
Actually,
okay, they
the
are
case.
The experiment. We are experimenting on children right now.
That's just demonstrably, you can easily demonstrate that that's not the
and
case.
And are you, Jacob, are you able to just use your common sense as well? I mean, you can rely on studies and you can just shout the word study at me and then start.
Let me finish.
You can shout about studies and list random medical organizations. That doesn't impress me. There was a time when every medical organization would have told you that, you know, bloodletting is the way to cure every disease.
Sure.
There was a time when every medical organization told you that the vaccine, you know, stopped transmission. So,
yeah.
But here's what I want to know. Are we able to just use common sense as well? And based on common sense, determine that it is certainly not a good idea to sterilize and castrate children and remove body parts from children before they are possibly old enough to consent to those procedures. Can't we just, don't we know that just based on basic moral decency and common sense?
Sure, but you're trying to make causal statements about the impacts of medical interventions. You need to demonstrate that with science. And I'm not mentioning, and I'm not like making an ethos argument, oh, like look at this organization. I'm saying that there are like very rigorous ways to substantiate your claims, and the people that are spending lots of time are doing that. And what they and they come to conclusions that are very different from the ones that you say. I'm not making an appeal to ethos. Anybody can look up these studies and just see how they're done.
Right, and these are also studies being done by the people who it just so happens are profiting from the procedures that they say work, which is really interesting.
Like,
but
do you think your professors are getting paid by like some?
Yeah, a lot of them are.
You think there's somebody like paying your professors for? I think you should.
How do you think it works, Jacob?
Because that's very unrealistic.
Do you think they're not being paid?
No.
They ain't doing this for free, I'll tell you that.
No. They're definitely being paid. But like if there's some shady organization paying them, like I'm sorry, that's sort of silly. Like talk with your professors. That's like sort of silly.
Okay. Let me at least ask
you know anything. There's always some conspiracy of
I think you can know things without asking for permission sometimes from professors to say that you know them.
No, I'm just saying,
and
like,
one of those things that you can know is that it's never okay to castrate a child. I mean, I don't need Jacob.
Thank you, Matt.
Okay. All right. Good conversation.